Good morning. Welcome in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. God's peace be with you. I'm Brother Mark Anderson, pastor of Laurel First United Methodist Church, along with Reverend Haven Boyd, our associate pastor, welcoming you now to join with us as we worship God and celebrate His faithfulness and His steadfast love.
Let us begin with the call to worship. All things bright and beautiful, God created for our enjoyment. All things wrenching and hard, God holds with tender care. You and I, neighbors and strangers, friends and enemies, God loves without condition. So let us worship God. Joy it is to affirm our faith on this morning. So join with me now in our affirmation of faith, which is the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
It's time for us to go to the Lord in prayer, and you've seen the prayer list that we have on the screen. This is such an important part of our ministry, and it's an important part of worship as well. So please keep these people in mind, and also, if you know of anyone else that we need to add to our intercessory prayer list, please let the office know. We want to keep this as current as we possibly can. So let's take a few moments now and bow our heads in silence as we open our hearts and our lives to God's Holy Spirit. Gracious Lord, we praise you, and we give you thanks for your love. And Lord, we want to say to you that we love you, and we long to love you more. We know that it is in this loving, Father, that we're able to experience your very presence in our lives, and also to be fully present for you and for those around us. Your love is the organizing principle of all things, and you want it to organize our lives so that we can be an agent of bringing your kingdom into this world. So, Lord, we thank you that you have first loved us, and you are teaching us now how to love one another. We thank you, Father, that you are very patient and merciful with us, that we are still a work in progress. Help us to know that that is happening under your providential care, and that you are faithful to us. You will never abandon us. We can give ourselves completely to you and trust in the good work that you are accomplishing in and through us. And so now, Lord, help us to hear the word that you have for us. Lord, help us to go and help us to be examples of that word, to be not only hearers, but doers of your word. We ask these things in the name of Jesus, who has taught us all to pray and say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Our scripture today comes from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 13, verses 31 and 32. Let us hear the word of the Lord. Jesus put before them another parable. The kingdom of heaven is like a mustard seed that someone took and sowed in a field. It is the smallest of all the seeds, but when it has grown, it is the greatest of shrubs and becomes a tree, so that the birds of the air come and make nests in its branches. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Jesus spent a lot of his time teaching on the kingdom of heaven or the kingdom of God. Just to give you an idea of how important this was to him, in his Sermon on the Mount, which was like Jesus' manifesto or his platform for what he intended to do in his ministry, Jesus says, "Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all other things will be added unto you." So big on Jesus' to-do list was to teach on the kingdom. And one of the things he loved to say about the kingdom was that it was very near to each one of us. In one place he said, it's in your midst. In another place he said, it is within you. So that is getting pretty close, isn't it? Perhaps even too close for comfort. Could there really be something amazing, something godlike going on all around us, and perhaps even within us, and we're not aware of it? Or whether or not we're aware of it, it's still going on. It seems that that's the case, according to Jesus. Of course, it's better for us to be aware of it. And so that's why Jesus gives us parables, so that we can be aware of it and also begin to participate in this amazing enterprise that God is carrying out in our very midst. So the parable of the mustard seed is a perfect example of this. Actually, in this parable, we get to see some of Jesus' wit and humor. Jesus loved to put an edge to his parables, and in this way, it made a deep impression on people. They would not only listen to what he said, but then they would carry it home with them, and it would play upon their minds and their consciences. And it would accomplish more things there than perhaps it would when they first heard it. So Jesus was always looking for ways to make that impression and that impact on a person's soul. And humor and wit was one of the ways he did it. He also used hyperbole in other places where he exaggerated things in order to impress a truth upon people. But here we have Jesus' wit and humor at work. And so we have a mustard seed that is not only considered one of the smallest of all seeds, but it's also considered one of the more common seeds. In fact, it's so common that the rabbis told people that they should never plant a mustard seed plant in their walled garden or private garden. They considered this a field crop, and that's what it was worth. It was worth throwing out into the open field. Let it fend for itself. And so you can imagine how this affected the people as they were listening to Jesus say that the kingdom of heaven is comparable to a mustard seed. Can you imagine how offensive that was to the rabbis? I can just see the twinkle in Jesus' eye and the tongue in cheek as he says this. So, we have the people grappling with this idea of the kingdom. For them, they would have much preferred something like the cedar of Lebanon. Now, that's something they would have gotten behind and been proud of, but a mustard seed. Come on, Jesus. Surely you're kidding. You're not giving yourself a chance. We'd be glad to follow you, but you're making it impossible for us. I think they probably carried this parable back home with them and began to realize, in spite of how uncomfortable it made them, that Jesus was making a pretty good point, even tongue-in-cheek and all. Both the mustard seed and the kingdom of heaven have very humble beginnings that are insignificant in the eyes of the world. And yet, as it turns out, the kingdom of heaven and the mustard seed provide something that is absolutely essential for the life and well-being of the world. They provide a place of safety, shelter, and provision. And in this parable, this is represented by the birds of the air who come and make their nest and care for their young deep within the safety of its branches. This parable sort of begins to be complicated here. And a part of the reason for that is because of the wit and the humor that Jesus is inserting into the story. To this day, commentaries on the Bible do not know what to do with the birds. And when the people heard it in Jesus' day, they was not for sure what he meant by the birds nesting in its tree. The parable is confusing Because there are some places in Scripture where birds are considered an evil influence. In other places, they're considered a good influence. The birds in this parable, say some commentaries, represents the Gentile nations that get to participate in the kingdom of heaven. Some say they represent evil forces. Others say the birds have no meaning at all in the passage, that actually we're just overthinking the passage. Well, there's a good reason for this confusion, and that's because birds have different symbols in the Bible. For instance, in the parable of the sower, just a little bit before this parable, it is the birds who are guilty of swooping down and stealing the seed, which represents the word of God, that had been cast upon the path. So in this situation, the birds are bad birds. But then we have Jesus using a humble sparrow as an example of God's benevolent care and love for all of his creation, and particularly for the crowning jewel of his creation. That's you and me. So in this case, the bird is a very good bird. So the verdict is sort of out. What does the bird represent? I, for one, believe that Jesus puts the birds in the parable for a very good reason. Maybe I'm sort of biased because I'm a little bit of a bird watcher. I've discovered that birds are complicated animals. They're some of the most intelligent in all of God's creation. They are capable of some of the most amazing feats in nature, and also at the same time, some of the most disgusting feats. I think the reason that we have this fascination with birds is because they have this wide range of capability. To be honest with you, it sort of weirds us out sometimes. It's almost like they're watching us and like they're plotting against us. You know, there's actually a classic horror movie by H.G. Wells about that. So, birds have a powerful impact on us and on how we think about ourselves and God's creation and our place in it. There's nothing more beautiful than seeing a red cardinal fly through the air or sitting on a branch, but at the same time, have you ever seen a cardinal when it was molting? I want to tell you, it's a rough-looking creature. It looks like the bird version of The Walking Dead. I'm not kidding. Most all birds molt, so that means many times during the year, these beautiful creatures of God are pretty hard to look at. Now, Jesus uses the birds of the air in a particular way in this passage. He says that they fill a tree, and the tree is laden with birds. Now, such an image would be a beautiful thing to behold from a distance. In fact, it would make the tree look like something that had come alive, sort of like the living trees in Middle Earth in The Lord of the Rings. You would almost expect this tree to lift its roots up and begin to walk across the ground. Birds in a tree from a distance just bring everything to life. But as you get closer to that scene, things begin to change. I once found myself under a tree filled with birds. And I want to tell you, from that angle, it's a different experience. The noise was deafening and very disturbing. And I could have swore that it had begun to rain. And then I found out real quick it wasn't rain, if you get my drift. I got out from under the tree pretty quick and began thinking about how the place to be is on the branches in that tree, not down on the ground. So since that day, I probably never quite listened to the parable of the mustard seed in the same way. I began to think of it in a more complicated way. I have a hunch Jesus is trying to say something about the kingdom of heaven that is far more complex and far more wonderful than our conventional way of thinking about it. You know what I mean? The sweet by and by way. Now don't get me wrong, I love that hymn. In fact, my grandmother used to sing it all the time, and I believe in its message. I believe that there is a land that is fairer than day, and by faith we can see it afar. For the Father waits over the way to prepare a dwelling place there. I believe in that, and that day is coming in God's time. But friends, the point Jesus is making in this parable is that the kingdom of heaven has come upon us now as well, such as we are. Friends, I think this is where the word of grace is for us today. God has graciously made a way for us to enter into his kingdom through faith in his Son, Jesus Christ. Praise God. There's really no other way that we can find ourselves in such a kingdom. And he says to us, come to me just as you are. But then he works in our lives so that we don't have to stay just as we are. Praise God for that too. You see, friends, Jesus is telling us that this enterprise that God is involved in through him and through his Holy Spirit in this world and in the world to come is a very long and thorough process. And the part of it that's taking place on this side of the Great Divide looks an awful lot like a bird-laden mustard tree that Jesus describes in this parable. I don't know about y'all, but there's something very encouraging about that to me, especially in light of all of the crazy that's going on around us, in the midst of us, especially in light of all the crazy that happens inside of us, within us. It's good to know that God has established a stronghold in the very midst, within all of this, to give us assurance that we have a place of safety, a place of security, a place where we can find provisions and promise for a future. You see, I believe the birds represent you and me, humanity. We're certainly complicated creatures, aren't we? A mixed bag. We're made in the image of God, capable of communing with him and sharing in God-like qualities, but at the same time, capable of going in the opposite direction and doing terrible things, even to the point of being guilty of some of the worst atrocities that this world has ever seen. Nevertheless, Jesus says, I have not come to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance. There will be more rejoicing in the kingdom of heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous persons who do not need to repent. So, maybe, just maybe, Jesus' reference to the birds of the air is the most meaningful and necessary part of this parable. After all, birds are problematic, just like us, at least for now. I want to leave you with this verse from a hymn. The hymn is for all the saints. O blessed communion, fellowship divine, we feebly struggle, they in glory shine, yet all are one in thee, for all are thine. May God give us the grace to not only hear his word, but to believe it, embrace it, and live it. Amen.
We invite you now to take this time to reflect on the words that Brother Mark has shared with us on this morning and to listen to how God is calling you to give of yourself, whether it's through your time, talents, tithe, or service. How will you give with a glad and grateful heart? So take this time now to be in conversation with God as the last hymn.
And now go in peace, and may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, the communion and fellowship of the Holy Spirit rest and abide with each of you, both now and forevermore.